Very good morning to all the lovely students of class plus 2C. So this is the very first lecture of 2022. I hope it goes well. And I wish for all of us that we keep learning in lives. Fine. You should also better look forward for the new learning. Okay. Already you have gone through the term one exam, which was quite tough, and your responses and your feedback was quite clear to me that how you felt difficulty, because we are not into regular learning. That is the problem. So problem is not with the question paper. Problem is with us that we stop learning somewhere. Okay. So let's take pledge in this new year to learn harder. So let's start with the very important poem. And definitely you will be getting this in exam. So this is that important. You can very well imagine a thing of beauty. So this is a kind of poem based off, you can say, one of the prominent poems of English literature written by John Keats. So you can see on the board, I have written one quote as per the theme of this poem. Fine, I will be discussing this. I will be sharing the screen with you all also, but you need to keep your books with you because I might ask you to note down some word meanings, some, you can say, points based on theme, the way we used to do in the class. Okay, so please, firstly, you can see I have written, beauty lies in the eye of beholder. What does this quote mean? Beauty lies in the eye of beholder. Anyone can tell me the meaning of this quote? Just raise your hand, or otherwise I will ask anyone to unmute. So you can speak. There is no, I'm not going to judge you or going to give you marks and all. You just tell me, what do you understand by this? Beauty lies in the eye of beholder. Yes, Amarpreet. Means the one who is observing. So Rasika says the one who is observing. Of beauty in the eyes of that person. Okay, the observer is having the beauty in his own eyes. Rasika, well done. Any other person? You can speak also rather than texting in the chat box. Yes, Amarpreet, according to you, what does this quote mean? Those who will not be unmuting themselves, I'll be marking them absent. It means they are not listening to me. Whatever you feel like. If you don't know the answer, you can say, ma'am, I cannot explain, but you have to participate in this. Yes, Amarpreet, you're not there, it means. Gaurav. He usually speaks in the class, so that's why I'm asking Gaurav. What do you understand?
Good morning, ma'am.
Yes, good morning, Gaurav. Tell me the meaning of this.
Ma'am, please repeat. There was a network issue.
Beauty lies in the eye of beholder. What does this quote mean? Okay, Anmol Nagpal is saying, it is a matter of personal opinion. Very good, Bitter. Very good. So let's start the discussion now. Beauty lies in the eye of beholder. It means that the way we perceive the things, fine. For one person, a thing can be beautiful. For the other person, the thing can be ugly. So whatever our thought process is, we are going to judge others. We keep on pointing out others that this person, you know, is beautiful, this person doesn't look nice, this person is very weird, and such kind of things. We keep on perceiving and judging others. We are quite judgmental about others. Fine. So beauty lies in the eye of beholder means how we perceive the outer beauty or inner beauty, or how we perceive the other person, that is actually the reflection of our own state of mind. Fine, we keep on, you know, pointing out negativity in others. It means problem is with us. If we are negative, we'll keep on finding the negativity around us. If we are positive, we'll even find out a prick of positivity from that person. Okay. So this poem, A Thing of Beauty, is actually going to teach us the importance of perceiving the things. Okay. So in a general theme, you can say that a thing of beauty is a joy forever. So whatever a thing of beauty for you it is, it gives you immense pleasure throughout your life. It can be your book for you if you are a regular reader. It can be your bike if you love your bikes. It can be anything, a person, a concept, an idea, your profession, natural beauty. Fine. So anything can be a thing of beauty for you. Every person has a different kind of thing. Thing doesn't mean only materialistic thing. It can be any idea also, okay? A thing of beauty is a joy forever. So according to the poet John Keats. So let me tell you about John Keats now. This young poet is very famous. John Keats is very famous for this romantic poetry in which he creates imaginary things, romance. Romance does not mean a boy and a girl having that affair. Find that kind of thing we start thinking. When we talk about romances in English, it means imaginary world. Where fiction is there, where imaginary things are there, okay? That is called a romance in English literature. So this poem is actually an extraction. This poem is taken from one other book written by John Keats. So I was telling you about John Keats. He died very young. He died at the age of 25 due to some illness. But he was a marvelous writer, marvelous poet he was. He was known for this romantic poetry. And this poem was the one of his, you can say, foundation poems, which gave him a lot of fame and name. So after this poem only, or Endymion. Clear? So you can see now on the board, I have already discussed. So I'm sure you're joining late, so you have missed the introduction. Now you can see that in the intro I have written, poem is taken from Endymion, a poetic romance. So I was telling you, romance is fiction. A tale, a story based on fiction, which is not real, which is imaginary, clear? And many characters might be there. So this is Endymion. I'll be telling you about this Endymion first. So Endymion is a poetic romance written by famous poet John Keats. Poet says that a beautiful thing is a source of continuous joy to us. So it can be any beautiful thing. Okay, so I have now, next thing you can see on the board is, after discussing the board, I will be sharing the screen. You can see the poem on it, fine. Things of beauty versus things of, you can say the things which inflict pain upon us, which gave us sadness, which are not good for us. So actually this poem is going to draw a comparison and contrast. Comparison means similarities, contrast means differences. Okay, so this poem is going to teach us that there are n number of things which are beautiful. Like God has given us so many beautiful things. So many beautiful things. The sun, the moon, shady trees, beautiful daffodil flowers, streams of water, dense green forests, and then tales of heroic men. Heroic men doesn't mean the movies. Heroic are those people who are dying for the sake of our country, who are giving lives, who are leading their lives for others, not for themselves. So they are the heroic people, okay? Like soldiers, the people in the social norms and you can say social works and all helping others. Then things are, which cause pain and sufferings to us. They are offending others, fine? And then hopelessness, when you are out of hope, gloominess is there, darkness is prevailing, poor health, unhappiness, darkness. So many things can be there. Depression can be there. So there are n number of things. So poet is going to demarcate between, he's going to tell us list of beautiful things and list of things which cause unhappiness to us. Clear? And now he is obviously, he's going to give us a message that let's choose happiness over sadness. Let's choose beauty over ugliness. Ugliness is there in the eye of a person only again. How can you define a beautiful person? The person who's having beautiful features and complexion and that kind of thing? No. A beauty should be inside out. Find the way you treat others, the way you perceive others, the way you, you know, talk to others, your mannerism, that is beauty. So according to the poet, a lot of things are there. Negativity is going to surround you in your lives. You will be surrounded by so many negative people, cruel people. So many mishappenings will be there in your lives. What you choose out of those things, that is your choice. Fine. I hope the introduction of the poem is clear to you all. Just show me. I'm just going to announce the names now. Those who are sending me thumbs up. Okay. Rasika, Anushka, Anmol, Lakshit, Rana Gurjeet, Sukhmanjot, Saransh, Chandan, Amarpreet, Suhani, Gaurav, Saransh, Kakshi is there, Srishti is there, Vaibhav is there. I'm just checking whether you're listening or not, because this is your own benefit if you will listen. If you're just passing the time, then you're lost. We can't do anything about it. So 26 participants are there. I expect more tomorrow. Okay, so let me now share the screen with you all. Okay, if you can see it, kindly send me thumbs up for that. Yes, Peta, is it visible to you? Is it visible? Yes, fine. Thank you, Peta. Okay, a thing of beauty. As you can see, introduction is clear to you that how, now I'll start this poem. Before even starting the poem, we need to tell you about the Endymion, a beautiful poetic romance written by John Keats. So, a thing of beauty about the poet, they have given one paragraph. Let me read that. John Keats was a British romantic poet. Although trained to be a surgeon, Keats decided to devote himself wholly to poetry. Keats' secret, his power to sway and delight the readers, lies primarily in his gift for perceiving the world and living his moods and aspirations in terms of language. You know, so he was a trained surgeon. You can very well imagine that John Keats at very young age, he was very intelligent, but his bent of mind, what his heart desired was to be a poet. So he was a very famous poet, and you know, it is a gift of God only. He was able to delight the readers. He was having the ability to sway the readers with his power of, you know, expression. So he was like in the form of different words, he was able to perceive, you can say express himself. The following is an excerpt from his poem. I told you already that this poem is, excerpt is part, right? So this is part from his poem, Endymion. Actually, he has written a very, you can say, a lengthy poem, Endymion. This is a poetic romance. Fine, romance, I already told you, the imaginary things and fiction. The poem is based on a Greek legend. Now, what is a legend? Legend is a kind of stories which travel from one generation to another generation. Fine, and they keep on the way your grandparents tell you tales. They are like, it is not authenticity that they are true. Okay, but they are legends only, traveling from one generation to other and so on. So this is based on a Greek legend. Which poem is based on Greek legend? Endymion. So please clear your facts. The answer is sunna aapne, okay? So in which Endymion is beautiful, who is Endymion? Endymion is actually name of a character. Okay, Endymion is a beautiful young shepherd and poet who lived on Mount Latmus, had a vision of Cynthia, the moon goddess. The enchanted youth resolved to seek her out and so wandered away through the forest and down under the sea. You should know this before reading the poem, because this poem is taken from Endymion only. So what happens in Endymion, this poetic romance, there was a boy, fine, and his name was Endymion actually. He's the, you can say, protagonist of this poem. So he actually had a vision. Vision is like imagination, fine. And he like had a vision of a moon goddess, the moon goddess, and her name was Cynthia. And he started, you know, he saw a beautiful girl in his dream, you can say, in his vision. There is one moon goddess and she's so beautiful. Her name is Cynthia. And, you know, he was a very casual, he was not that rich. And he was just a shepherd, fine, taking the, you can say, straws here and there in the forest and taking the animals over there and looking forward to it. So He was just a shepherd only. So he had a vision of Cynthia one day, the moon goddess. And, you know, he decided that very day that I'm going to find out this girl. I'm going to look forward to find this moon goddess, how beautiful she is. And he was so enchanted. He was too attracted towards the beauty of that girl. So he started wandering through the forests. He started going through the sea area or a forest area, started looking forward for that moon goddess named Cynthia. Okay, so that is the basic introduction. So that happens in Endymion, not in your poem, A Thing of Beauty. But in the beginning, now let's talk about this. So this is the basic introduction from which this excerpt is taken, this poem is taken from Endymion. Clear? So Endymion is about Cynthia and Endymion only. Before we start reading, what pleasure does a beautiful thing give us? Are beautiful things worth treasuring? So poet is asking a question that what pleasure does a beautiful thing give us? Firstly, we should know what is a beautiful thing. For a person, it can be your sister, your brother, your mother, your father. Find your spouse, your life partner, or your children. Or if it is not a person, it can be, you can say, a bird singing over there. It can be a mountain area. It can be a cool breeze. Fine. It can be in the lap of nature. It can be you're lying and relaxing in your garden of your home. It can be a cozy bed or sofa. Fine. So, what pleasure does a beautiful thing give us? Are beautiful things worth treasuring? So poet is asking that what happiness does a beautiful thing give us? It gave us actually according to the poet. Now poet is going to tell us that what is the duty or of a thing of beauty. Okay. So a thing of beauty is a joy forever. Its loveliness increases. It will never pass into nothingness, but will keep a bower quiet for us. I'm just going to recite the poem, then I will start explaining stanza wise to you. Okay, so according to the poet, the very better, firstly, you just underline first two lines of the poem. Actually, this is the theme of this poem, A Thing of Beauty. Okay, a thing of beauty is a joy forever, its loveliness increases. This is the base of this poem. If you, anybody asks you what is the theme of this poem, this is the theme, okay? Because the thing of beauty is a source of continuous joy for all of us, okay? And its loveliness keep on increasing. It's keep on increasing in our life. So it will never pass into nothingness. Its value will never diminish. Its value will always keep on increasing, fine? So I'll be explaining line wise, but firstly, let me recite because this is the beauty of the poem when you recite it. A thing of beauty is a joy forever. Its loveliness increases. It will never pass into nothingness, but will keep a bower quiet for us. At a sleep full of sweet dreams and health and quiet breathing. Therefore, on every morrow, are we breathing a flowery band to bind us to the earth? Spite of despondence, of the inhuman dearth, of novel natures, of the gloomy days, of all the unhealthy and over-darkened ways, made for our searching. Yes, in spite of all, some shape of beauty moves away the pall from our dark spirits. Such the sun, the moon, trees old and young, sprouting a shady boon. For simple sheep and such are daffodils, with green world they live in, and clear rills that for themselves a cooling covert make, against the hot season, the mid-forest break. Rich with the sprinkling of fair musk rose blooms, and such too is the grandeur of the dunes we have imagined for the mighty dead. All lovely tales that we have heard or read, an endless fountain of immortal drink, pouring unto us from the heaven spring, pouring unto us from the heaven spring. So this is the poem I just recited. I know you don't know the meaning yet, but yes, we should feel the poem first and then I'll be explaining it to you. Because we are just left with, I guess, 10 minutes. Okay, so let's see how many stanzas or lines we'll be able to Understand. Okay. So just send me your feedback if it is all clear to you about the theme. Okay. Rasika is saying yes. Rasika, can you read first five lines of the poem for me? Rasika.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, please read first five lines, still breathing.
A thing of beauty is a joy forever. Its loveliness increases. It will never pass into nothingness, but will keep a bower quiet for us and asleep, full of sweet dreams and health and quiet breath.
Thank you so much, Rasika. Beautifully read and recited, I can say. Fine. Now, let's see. Firstly, the meaning of the word bower in this. What is the meaning of this word bower? Please note down. It means a shady place under the tree. Because all other words are very easy. The only word I would like to tell you the meaning of is bower. B-O-W-E-R. Underline this word bower. It means a shady place under the tree. It can be any corner. Fine, at the green place, at in the forest, in the any natural surroundings. So a bower is a shady place under the tree. You might have seen that when you visit parks and all, there are benches. Specifically, they keep the benches under the shade of the tree only. And there are a lot of trees and branches, the shade they provide to the people who are sitting there. So fine, you can say that place of bower, clear? So bower is a place which is a shady place under the tree, okay? Then let me now explain. Poet says that a thing of beauty is a continuous source of joy for all of us. Fine, a thing of beauty can be anything. It can be any natural beauty place. It can be any person, anything. Okay. So according to the poet, anything which is beautiful, it is a source of continuous joy for us. And its loveliness, its beauty, it keeps on increasing only. Its value will never diminish. Its value will keep on increasing in our lives. It will never pass into nothingness. Nothingness means nothing. Zero. Fine. So according to poet, it will never pass into nothingness. That it stands for a thing of beauty. Fine. That thing of beauty will never pass into nothingness. It will keep on giving us happiness. It will keep on giving us comfort. It will keep on soothing our lives. Fine. But will keep a bower quiet for us. Now, according to the poet, such kind of beautiful things, they are like a shady place for us. In the, you can say, scorchy heat, the bower is the place which provides us shade. So according to the poet, these beautiful things, they are going to work as bower for us. They are the shady place for us, which are going to save us from all the hot, harsh realities of life. Fine. So there are a lot of harsh realities in life. There are a lot of gloominess, there are a lot of negative things. But think of beauties will always be there for us, which will be working as a bower quietly for us. And now, when we get such beautiful things in our lives, when we perceive such beautiful things in our lives, number one, now please keep remember one thing, that one process. Firstly, these beautiful things give us a kind of shady place. You can say you will get calm out of this. Secondly, when you are satisfied, when you are at peace, what will you get? You will get a sleep full of sweet dreams. Now, let me associate here. When you are not happy, when you never had suppose you didn't have a good day, you won't be able to sleep. You won't be able to have a sound sleep. You will have, your sleep will be disturbed with sometimes nightmares. Sometimes you are disturbed. You're not able to, you will have what we call that. You won't be able to sleep. There is a term for this. It's not coming to my mind right now related to when you are not able to sleep. I'll be telling you later on. So you will have a sleep full of sweet dreams. When you will have a sleep full of Sweet dreams, when you had a good day, when positive things, when you concentrated on positive things, when you were happy during the day, only then you will get good sleep with full of sweet dreams. And then if you are sleeping soundly, if you are having good sleep, what will happen? You will have a good health. So you can see, and health and quiet breathing. Fine, you will get good health and quiet breathing. You know that our breathing system, if you are angry, when you are not happy, your breathing system will be fast. When you're angry, you're yelling at someone, you're fighting with your sibling, you're like, why did you do this? Why did you do that? You're breathing, you start breathing heavily. Fine. So when you are at peace, when you're not angry with anyone, when you are happy, when you're satisfied, you just see your breathing system will be very relaxed, at peace, calm, fine. So this is what poet is trying to say. Poet is saying, a thing of beauty is a continuous source of joy. So please let me, I will be just five lines we'll be doing today because only 4 minutes are left. And then I will ask any one of you to explain these five lines. Okay. So very, in a very easy language, I'm telling you, according to the poet, poet says that beauty stays forever. Fine. Beauty stays forever. Clear? It never fades away. Its value never diminishes. Fine. It is like it beautifies more and more. Fine. The beauty multiplies further. It will never pass into nothingness. It will keep on increasing. It will also provide us the bhava quite of for us means a beauty is like a beautiful shady tree. So according to the poet John Keats, beauty is like a beautiful shady tree which keeps on providing shade to us for years. Fine. Its shade will always be there. We go and sit over there. We go and then again we go reach that place. We sit and we go. We keep on coming and going, but tree will always be there. That beautiful shady place will always be there. And when we have a beautiful thing of beauty, when we have perceived a beautiful thing, then what will happen? We will get a sweet, we will have sweet dreams. We'll get good sleep. Our health will be very good and our breathing will be in accordance to our health. Fine, that will be very good. It means you will enjoy, you will relish good health, you will relish good sleep, you will enjoy your sweet dreams when you have perceived a beautiful thing. So this is what in the very first five lines of the poem poet has said. Okay, so now who will explain it, or otherwise I will ask anyone. Let me ask Prabhnoor Kaur. Prabhnoor, please explain these five lines. Prabhnoor Kaur, yes, better. Your voice is not audible.
Ma'am, according to the poet, the thing of beauty is forever. Its values always increases, it beautifies, and it will never deteriorate. And it's just like a shady tree that provides us calmness, and it relishes good health, and good sleep that will.
Yes, so this is what poet John Keats has taught us, that beauty lies in the eye of beholder, how we perceive the things, and beautiful things are continuous source of joy for us. Its loveliness will keep on increasing. It will never diminish into nothingness, and it will affect our health also. Beautiful things, they give us good sleep, good health, sweet dreams, and our life is all set when we start perceiving the positive things in our life. When we concentrate on positive things, we will get positive. If we concentrate on negativity, we will get negative things. So this is what poet is trying to say. Yes, Rasika, thank you. So that word which I was talking about was insomnia. Fine. It means lack of sleep. When you're not able to have a sound sleep and you keep on awaking through the whole night during the lockdown days, it happened. Now let's see, you have to manage your days in a well behaved manner. Okay, please be disciplined. So today we have 26 students, and please those who are attending today. Please do attend tomorrow also, because we will be able to finish this poem, a very important poem, along with question answers, along with literary devices. Okay, so with this first period of 2022 ends. I hope you had a good experience. Send me your feedback, those who attended the lecture very attentively. And Mol Nagpal is the first one to do that. Okay, Vaibhav, Lakshit, Prabhu, Rasika, Sukhman Jodh, Vanshika, Kakshi, Anushka, Chandan, Harnoor Singh, Rana Gurjeet is there. Okay, so Srishti, fine. I am not able to take all the names, sorry for that. Have a good day, beta. Okay, and keep learning.